Welcome to the She Is podcast by Refuge City Church. We are here to have a Bible-based conversation about who you are in Christ.
Welcome. Thank you. Welcome. Hold on. That is so good to us.
Our fake audience.
Then we push a button and they go, woohoo!
You know, no, somebody could be cheering in their car.
They could.
Oh, that thank would be fun.
I'm going to start cheering.
Yes. Yay. Well, we're all here. Yes. And we have Shreya joining us.
Thank you.
Yay. So how's your day?
It's been a minute since we've recorded. Hi, what's your name?
Do we know? Would you like me to introduce everyone? Welcome back, everybody. Welcome back.
It's good to be back.
Oh, good.
Yes.
Good. Well, it's not like anybody was really sick or anything, just doing things.
Yeah. Life happened.
Yeah.
It's the time of year.
Right.
We can't sing.
Well, she made that song.
It was
up.
Incidental.
Okay, all the times I sing then are incidental.
What is that small print at the end of like movies? And it's like any characters or events that seem to represent like real life is like completely coincidental.
Completely coincidental.
Yes. So hustle there.
So hustle there.
So that's my small print.
There you go. Oh, good. Good.
Completely coincidental.
Did we sign a contract? Was I not here that day when we signed?
We came in late.
Yeah, the two of you came in late, but the three of us didn't do a contract, so I think we're good.
Sweet.
It's whatever, right?
We're not bound by anything.
We aren't.
There are no rules.
So we're just you do you, boo.
And we enjoy every minute. Yes. Well, today, Shreya is going to share with us her journey that she got to go to Africa, and there's a whole story in that, so I'm going to let her tell us that. It's such a blessing. It's a sweet story. But before that, we're going to do our funsies.
Yay! And I get to do it this time. So we always do these. Okay. So we're going to guess where these weird or unique surnames come from around the world. So I have seven surnames.
Okay. Can you define for us
last
what a surname
names?
Okay.
Last right. names.
That's okay. what I thought, but I
fancy language.
I've been out of school for a week. So
we don't make fools out of ourselves.
Or when I do, I can't excuse it away.
It's often for me. All right. So the first one is Bella Gama. Mm. And it means, or should I guess where it's from and then I'll tell you what it means?
I'm going to say Italy.
Oh, that's what I was thinking.
High five.
Bella Gama.
We win. You have to say it like that. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Germany?
Okay, Germany, Italy.
I feel like there's not enough phlegm in it for Germany.
Oh, you're right. I bet you're right.
I want to look at a map.
It's going to be
Norway again.
Rome or Greece?
Oh, right. Rome. Right. Okay. So Italy, too, or Greece?
Greece.
Ooh. Hold on. I'm Googling a map. I can't think.
Like a random country.
I thought you were Googling the name.
It thinks I want to. No, I'm not. I'm not cheating. I'm just looking at a map. But now Amazon thinks that I want to buy a map. I'm like, no. We're good. Okay, Bella Gama.
Bella Gama.
Okay.
Croatia.
Oh, good one.
Okay.
What is it?
It is Italian.
Yes! Yeah. Oh, I was going to say that, but I'm like, I don't want to be like everybody else. I'll pick somewhere close to Italy.
There you go. I mean, it means Bella. Beautiful leg.
What is that?
Bella Gama. Oh,
that makes sense. Bella is because gams is like legs.
Is it? Oh. I didn't know that. That's so funny.
Beautiful legs.
Beautiful.
So we're so
just
we're,
one.
I think it's
just one of your legs. Is
I
beautiful.
Think it's Bella Gama or Bella Gamba. There's a B in there, so I don't
Bella
know.
Gamba. I think Bella Gamba. B in Italian is silent
like,
sometimes.
Gama. Yeah,
not that's what
Gamba.
I thought. Like how it's Spanish, the J.
It's like it's Gam.
Right.
You call your grandma Gam Gam.
Either way,
it's a Gam leg.
Fun name to say. Either way.
Okay, this one's my favorite. Shuffle bottom.
Oh.
How do I feel like that's British?
Yeah. Okay. That reminded me of Mr. Ramsbottom from, was it the Minions? So I would go with British because
Ramsbottom.
He was British in the movie.
What is it again? Shufflebottom?
Shufflebottom.
Mm.
Iceland.
Or Swedish.
Ooh. Iceland, Swedish, British.
Okay. Yeah, no, I think Britain.
Yeah.
British.
Yeah. I'm in agreement.
You are all right. Who said British?
Yes. See, that's what I get for trying to not be like everybody else. I'm wrong.
Unique, not
being
wrong.
Like us, it's going to work one of these times.
They think in like England and stuff, they did your surname based on your like profession.
Your job, yeah.
Why is
Which
this?
Would be so you shuffle your bottom?
Dancer.
What job would that
be?
Run
dancing.
All the time.
Dancing.
Choreographer.
Dancer. Dancing. Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Next one is bigger staff.
Bigger staff.
I guess so like maybe a shepherd?
Does that mean he's really tall?
With a staff?
Ireland. So then, yeah.
Ireland.
That's what I was thinking. With the staff.
Bigger stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Wasn't there an American president that said something about carrying a big stick or something?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think it's us.
I think it's us.
I think it came from us.
Yeah. Carry a bigger stick than everybody else.
Oh, gosh.
Texas.
Ireland. Here.
America.
Ireland.
Ireland.
Maybe Irish or Scottish.
Mm. Oh, yeah. Bigger stuff.
I'm going to go Sweden.
Sweden.
Mm. They had a lot of answers last time.
They did. They have a lot of staff.
I'm just trying to be neutral.
Yeah.
This one is actually British as well.
Oh.
Oh.
They were a shepherd. Mm. All right. Next one is fully love.
France.
Probably.
Yeah.
It sounds floofy.
Right.
That's a good word.
Floofy.
Scotland.
Scotland.
Okay. Australian.
Ooh.
Knight.
You gotta say it with the accent.
Fully love.
Fully love.
Good job. I can't do it very good.
I'm Hannah Fully Love. Thanks for coming
fully
tonight.
Fully loved by the kangaroos.
And the creator.
And the
all
creator.
Right. Are all our answers in?
I think so.
Okay.
I'm neutral.
It is French.
Oh, it is a floofy name.
Good job.
Okay. I got one right.
Some of you might know this one. Remember it from an old show.
Ooh.
Clampett.
Oh. Hillbillies.
Definitely America.
Definitely
the
America.
Clampets.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Alabama.
Huh. Clampett?
Clampett.
Mm-hmm. Here. Yeah.
Beverly Hills?
Beverly Hills.
Like, that's where they ended up. That's not where they started.
Right.
Right. Deep south of America.
I'm going to say the Netherlands.
Oh, that's a good one.
This one, I think it's from all over because it says Old English.
Oh.
But it means mud pit. Which totally makes sense with the Beverly Hillbillies.
Right. Have you told us the meaning of the last?
The other ones didn't have... any meanings. I mean, they're kind of self-explanatory. Shuffle bottom is...
I don't know. I want an explanation.
I need to know. What profession did that come from?
Maybe they're a shuffle.
The next one
they're
is
like
really
dancing.
Bumstead.
Bumstead.
This is more of like a language than a region.
Yeah.
So.
Oh.
For real?
Irish. Yeah.
Oh.
I say Irish.
Irish.
Bumstead.
Dutch. Dutch?
Maybe Dutch.
Is that what you said?
Okay. I'm going with British again.
I'm going to go with New Zealand.
Oh, New Zealand.
Yes.
The Kiwis.
The natives.
Land of the Kiwis.
Aussies.
Gosh.
I don't think
did
that's
I break
a country.
Her brain?
I'm going to go Holland.
Holland.
Oh,
wow. Okay.
Whoa.
It is also Old English. It means waste shed. I think it means a bathroom. Is that what that would mean?
A toilet.
A waste shed.
The loo.
Okay.
What was it? Bumshed?
Bumstead.
Bumstead.
Yeah.
Well, homestead. Bumstead.
Oh.
I mean, it is where your mom
homestead
lives.
Is in a bathroom.
Yeah, but
bumstead.
What does homestead mean?
It's where you live.
I don't know.
It's your
a
home.
A place for animals and farm
so,
stuff.
It's where you live.
A bumstead is a place for your bum.
It's where your bum lives. Feels home there.
Sorry. Yeah, you need to speak into your microphone when you're speaking.
Sorry,
speaking.
So, all right.
Far away.
So they can hear you. Yes. Last one.
I don't think they really wanted me to explain that.
All right, last one. Wario.
Super Nintendo.
Nintendo. I'm going to go Italian on that too.
Italian? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
Oh, that's true. Because that's where Mario and Luigi come from.
It is.
Right.
Is that allowed in our contract?
I'm just thinking that we don't have. Okay.
It's a knee.
That is not allowed.
It's a knee. I was wall jumping.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Sorry, I was wall Wario jumping.
Go ahead.
Wall jumping.
Did everyone put in their answer?
We have to jump up the wall.
In like Mario, in Mario, like Brothers. You're going across the screen.
Yeah. Wah, ho, like that.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
and he's like no stuff either because I don't play video games.
His awkward never sounds did. Make him jump higher.
So. All I can think of
awkward
is
sounds makes him jump higher. Okay, it is Japanese and it means bad guy.
Okay, so okay.
Which totally makes
Super
sense.
Mario was invented in Japan.
Yeah, but they use like they he's use Italian plumber. Names yeah. like yeah. Mario and yeah. Luigi yeah.
and they're which. Plumbers.
Yeah. Which there's is plumbers in clearly Italian.
There's plumbers in Japan.
I hope so. There's a lot of people there. That would be
that
a problem.
Makes so much sense because Nintendo was created in Japan.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Dang it.
So,
I'm not going to think
tricky.
Of that.
Tricky.
I failed the nerd.
You got me.
All right. That is all I have for funsies.
Apparently, we need prayer.
Yeah.
That's all I have. She broke my brain.
Yeah. Sorry.
So, Wario means bad guy?
It means bad guy I like in that. Japanese.
That makes funny. So much
That's
sense.
That's what Google told me anyway.
So. He has a villain mustache.
Yeah. And if you have a villain mustache,
you're a bad guy.
Sorry, all the guys out there with mustaches listening.
You're
if it's,
oh my gosh.
I don't know.
Fix your mustache.
Sorry. Just remembering a time when Colton shaved his beard. And it just was very sad dear. For me. Sad for my life. Anyways, carry on.
A temporary bad guy.
Sorry for your loss.
Because he had a mustache, and I was just like, no, you can't do that.
Doesn't anyways, fit your carry face. On.
Rabbit trail.
Emotional trauma.
Okay.
Emotional damage.
All right, guys, come back. Okay. Let's pray.
There's the lasso.
I just made a shower of saliva.
Bring it back.
No, it's the moment is past.
It's
too late for tissue. All right. Dear Lord, we thank you for today. Thank you for fun and for laughs and for friendship, Lord. We just pray that you would bless the words that come out of Shreya today. Mm-hmm. Thank you for using her as your vessel, Lord. We thank you for the work that you've been able to do around the world. You're just so mighty and so big and bigger than our dreams, Lord. You are just amazing, and we are in awe of you. We love you so much, and just thank you for your presence. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 So, Shreya, yes. We're going to pick your brain.
Woo-hoo! But not break it.
No, we won't break it. Your brain is so big, Shreya. It's fine.
So big. Not sure what it's full of, but it's really big.
We're about to find out.
Yep. So, we thought it would be really fun to have you here and talk about your time in Africa and just starting out. I thought it would be cool to hear like how long you've been wanting to really like travel and minister to people and how that kind of came about. So,
So I have always just really loved to travel. I've loved history and learning about different cultures, even as a kid. Like history was my favorite class in school. And always just wanted to see the world, and I just thought Africa was so amazing when I was little. And so throughout high school and stuff, wanting to travel and go on missions trips, but I was a poor kid. So I had, when I graduated high school, I moved up north towards the Portland area and lived there and got to do some missions trips within the United States. And when I came back to Klamath, it was just such a God thing because I was sitting actually like at the very back of a service here at Refuge, and a video came on for an opportunity to go to Mozambique and see Pastor Eric and Tanya in Dondo. And I didn't even know them because I had been away when they were here. And the video came on, and I just felt this instant excitement in my heart. Mm-hmm. And I felt the Holy Spirit say, "You're going." And I was like, "To Africa?" He's like, and so I just got this excited look on my face, and my mom looked over, and she's like, "What?" And I was like, "I'll tell you later." And so just praying that out, and God just opened every door
for that to happen in my time there was so amazing, and have had multiple opportunities to travel the world. I've gotten to go to Mozambique and Cambodia and Mexico. And then God is just so good how we think that sometimes our dreams fail and how he reignites them. Mm-hmm. Because in 2019, we were actually slated to go back to Mozambique again. Mm-hmm. And that is when the cyclone had hit southern Mozambique first and then northern Mozambique. And it was devastating for the people there. And so we had postponed the trip. And then we were going to go in 2020. And again, that trip got postponed due to travel restrictions and just safety. And I really had to pray against hope deferred because my heart was, I felt heartsick. I had sorrow in my heart because I was like, God, you gave me this dream to go back to Africa. I went there. I absolutely fell in love with the people and the culture. And it was such a humbling experience that I definitely learned, like, don't ever take anything for granted because, you know, we'll complain if our cell phone dies and we're like, oh my gosh, you know, my pants are worn out. My shoes are worn out. And they're like, you have shoes? In even some places. Mm-hmm. And so it was just so good. And so come 2022, my heart was grieved because I was like, God, you gave me this dream. And now it is looking like it's never going to happen again. Why would you give me this dream and give me this desire to be able to travel the world and let me dip my toe in the pool? And then it never happened. Because we were not planning on ever rescheduling the trip back to Mozambique for quite some time. And so just through prayer and trusting the Lord and obviously the obedience of our incredible Pastor Jim, we had a Sunday night service here at the church, and he had known my heart. He's gotten to travel with me. He's seen me travel. And just really poured into me. And so he approached me after service one night and was like, hey, so you want to go back to Africa? And I was like, is that a question? Or because I mean, you already know the answer. You don't have to ask it. Just tell me when. And so he had brought the opportunity to me of getting to go to Kenya, which I had met some people who were in Kenya, just working in the medical field and traveling around, and I was like, these people are amazing. So he had brought that up to me, and I was so excited. And he's like, well, you know, there's a lot of stuff in the works. They're looking for a young single female to go. And he's like, I didn't even have to think about it. Like, you instantly came to my mind. So how does a couple months feel? And I was like, what? I was like, I thought that was just a short trip. And he's like, no, I feel like you're ready.
That's awesome.
And it was so good. And again, like seeing God's hand in everything, when in the natural, our heart and our emotions deceive us. Mm-hmm. So we were slated to go in October of 22. And that fell through. And I was like, seriously, God, we need to sit down and have a conversation because my emotions can't take this anymore. And just through the goodness of God and praying that out, I got to go in January of 2023. And every door opened up. There were no roadblocks. And you know it's a God thing when other people can catch that dream and vision right alongside you. So I'd be in the grocery store and people would be like, so I heard you're going to Kenya. And I'm like, yeah. And they're like, here's $200. And I was like,
come on.
Oh my gosh. So I paid out of pocket, I paid for like a third of my trip.
That's amazing.
Because people just poured into that because they catch the vision that God has. And a lot of people are like, well, I'm going to live vicariously through you because I'm not going there. You know, and they're like, well, I hope you enjoy your time. And I hope it's a great vacation. And I'm like, it's not a vacation at all. But thank you. I will.
Right.
I got to go there with a short period of time with a team from the United States. And then we actually met Pastor Eric and Tanya there. And they were there with us for a short period of time. And then they all came home. And I got to live there for 2 months, which was absolutely amazing. And so I think just, you know, God put that desire in my heart to get to share his love with other people. Yeah. And what better way to get to share that with people who are so hungry and will cling on to everything that you say about Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
That's so cool.
That was amazing.
So can you tell us about what you did when you were there? Yeah. Both with the team and then after they left, like your extended stay, what was that about?
So when we arrived, they had had a leadership conference at the church, which is Fountain Worship. And so getting to minister to a lot of the pastors who had come from all over, we were staying in a city called Nakuru. And so people would walk for miles and miles to come to this or drive for miles if they had cars. And so we got to minister to the church leadership as well as other pastors and ministers throughout the city of Nakuru and the surrounding areas, which was absolutely amazing. And then we did a women's conference, which was so, so incredible, and getting to minister to the women of the city of Nakuru and just get to share with them their value and how much God loves them, which was so amazing. And for me, I was, I'd never been there. And so out of everybody that was there, they were either on staff or a couple that had gone with us had been there from the very beginning and had such a really strong relationship. And so I was like sitting there at some point where I'm like, I need to pinch myself because how in the world is this real? It was so humbling and just so incredible. And then we had, which I absolutely loved that. And then we had my favorite opportunity, which we actually went out to Jami House, which is the Jami Home Care. It's a children's home on the outskirts of Nakuru. It's actually like out in the middle of a village. And so it's what you think. Like there's no roads and everything is dirt and no streetlights. but it was so amazing. And so we got to meet the absolutely wonderful children that live there full time at Jami Home and just love on them and get to play games with them. And they did some performances for us, which were absolutely incredible. And those kids can dance like no one's business. Like every one of them. I'm like, I'm pretty sure it's like if you're born in Kenya, like you're naturally a good dancer. They were insane. And we just got to love on them. And so that was incredible. So our team had come back to the States and everyone had dispersed. And so I stayed with Pastor Esther, who is the pastor of Fountain Worship. I stayed at her home for a week, which was a huge honor to get to be there and just kind of learn how to live life with them and how they do things every day that we just take for granted. You're like, I'm just going to, you know, throw my clothes in the washing machine and put them in the dryer. And we're out there for 3 hours washing every piece of clothing by hand and hanging it up on the line, hoping it doesn't rain or there's not a dirt storm.
Oh, my gosh.
And so I lived with her family for about a week. And then I would spend my weekends in Nakuru as well. But during the weekdays, I actually had a room at Jami Home, so I got to live at the children's home, which was I can't even describe it, you know. Like there was cooking and cleaning and laundry and stuff, but getting to spend every day with the children and waiting for them to come home from school was absolutely incredible, you know. And I'm not married and don't have kids, but I can only imagine what it feels like to be a mom because the love that I have for those kids, I was like, this is a glimpse of the Father's love for us because I instantly fell in love with every one of them. And I call them my kids because they just impacted my life. And getting to just tell them about who Jesus is, because they know a lot of Jesus. They know a lot of the Word. They don't know Jesus a lot. So they memorize the songs, they memorize the stories, and so getting to spend time with them and just share with them about their value of who Jesus made them to be, you know, who God created them to be, and what Jesus did for them was so, so amazing. So I got to do that for 2 months, and obviously some really cool fun things as well. I got to go on a safari and see animals and feed giraffes and pet baby elephants. So
that's awesome.
But yeah, it was absolutely life-changing. very humbling experience as well.
Yes. Yeah, that would be. It's like, it's completely different over there. And I think just getting to see a different mode of life is so valuable. Like, you know, you have no idea how good you have it until you see what other people live through. And then also getting to just do life with them is so amazing. Like, so.
Yeah, so awesome. It was interesting. You know, they have missionaries come all the time and bring gifts and food and supplies and stuff, and they never had anybody outside of Kenya go and stay at Drumming House. So we actually had to, like, remodel a whole bedroom.
Oh, wow.
So I still have a bedroom there, so it's kind of my second home, actually. But it was very humbling. Mm-hmm. You can't take anything for granted whatsoever. I mean, you know, they pass down clothes. They, you know, if a shirt has a, you know, it's pink or whatever, but it fits one of the boys better than one of the girls, they're going to wear it.
Yeah.
You know, we had electricity go out days at a time.
Oh, wow.
So we're like, all right, keep your phones charged. As soon as the electricity would go out, and it happened in the city and in the village, where as soon as the sun goes down, you just go to bed. Wow. Like, you don't, there's no flashlights, there's no lanterns, you don't do fire because that wastes resources. Mm-hmm. So you just go to bed at 8 o'clock and wake up when the sun's up. And, you know, it was a lot of work, you know, cleaning up after the kids and helping clean the dorms and cook meals. But it made me so thankful for every single thing that I have. Because we, you know, here in America, we are so comfortable. And so I had an opportunity to speak to our youth kids about my trip. And so Hannah and I talked to them, and I challenged the kids. I was like, you know, if any of you ever want to do something like this, you have to be willing to be uncomfortable for the sake of Jesus Christ, for the sake of the gospel. You know, and so I did give them a challenge. I was like, if you're willing to go to Africa and be uncomfortable and lose electricity or not have water, not have clean water, not, you know, all of these different things, I challenge you to be willing to be uncomfortable here first. Because if we can't be uncomfortable in our own place, if we can't be inconvenienced in our day-to-day life here, if we're not willing to give up something for somebody, if we're not willing to take a little bit of extra time or mess up our schedule, or give something away that is special and precious to us, then how can we be expected to do it there? Because then it's not out of a genuine heart.
Right.
It's out of a, you know, look what I can do. I don't ever encourage somebody to go overseas for their 5 minutes of TikTok fame and Instagram pictures. Right. Yeah, don't do because that. You are in for a rude awakening. But yeah, I loved it. And it was a blessing and an honor to be able to be inconvenienced for the gospel.
Yeah.
Sorry. So, I mean, obviously, you can see God's fingerprints throughout your whole story and getting you there. But is there anything in particular that you really felt like during that time God was really working on you in?
Yeah. So I, you know, I got saved when I was little, and I've always had a really strong relationship with Christ and walked that path out growing up and even as an adult, you know, doing ministry and youth ministry and stuff. God really worked on my heart, which I had no idea was going to be preparing me for something even harder when I got home. But learning to praise Him through sorrow and praise Him through every trial. You know, Isaiah 43:2 tells us, you know, just to kind of paraphrase, we're not going to be spared from the fire. We're not going to be spared from the waves. He promises us that he's going to go through us with it. You know, you will not be overtaken. You will not drown. You will not be burned up, and the flames will not consume you. God doesn't promise that we're going to be spared. He promises us that if we trust in Him and put our faith in Him, He will walk through us, you know, through it with us. And so while we were there, it was actually our second day in Kenya. I had gotten a phone call from my dad that one of my family members had passed away that I was really close with. And I was like, oh my gosh, I can't go home. I can't be with my family. I'm here for 2 months. It was literally my second day. And learning, you know, I sat on my bed. I bawled my eyes out, went to breakfast, got, you know, hugs and prayers from my team. And I had to pull myself up by my bootstraps because we had ministry to do, like 30 minutes later, and keep going. And so going through that process of grief and sorrow of losing somebody that I loved so much while overseas and still having to operate in ministry and not wear it. Because I think sometimes when we lose people, we can definitely wear that as a badge. And, you know, you want everybody to know that you're sad and you're grieving and get the I'm so sorry. And so learning to just worship and praise God through that and still process my grief and my emotions, but not let it trip me up whatsoever. Because we had a mission to do. We had an assignment to do. And so it was so good because in that season – I had to FaceTime my family at midnight, our time in Kenya, for the funeral. So I was on FaceTime for a funeral with my whole family. And by that time, I was completely alone. The team from America had come back to the States. And so going through that, and it was hard because I was getting to know everybody in Kenya still. And so, like, you know, not sure how they process grief over there because it's a completely different culture. And going through that step of losing somebody and trying to be there for my family, being literally on the other side of the world and not letting that falter my walk at all. And so it was so good because I really, in that season, learned, God, no matter what happens, you know, if I get married and have a family, that's great. If I, you know, whatever I walk through, you and it's you and I through everything. You're my first love. You're the steadfast one in my life. You're the one that I cling to and I lean on through every situation. And so I love it because he utilized something that was so painful in my heart to bring glory to himself and help me learn and grow through that. So that was really cool. And also just loving people. Learning to lay everything down and be inconvenienced and uncomfortable because not everything is easy over there.
Yeah.
So it was so good. Definitely humbled me for sure.
Awesome. Yeah, I just think like when God puts you through those situations, it is uncomfortable. But I think our perspective changes too. And that can be so valuable. So I just love your heart in that, that you were steadfast and you're like, God, I don't, I know this sucks. Like it's painful. It's, but he's with us no matter what. And that is such a great lesson to learn. So thank you so much for being here with us. And does anybody else have anything before we?
I actually had a question. So I know you guys had a really difficult time getting over there.
Oh, my goodness.
And so maybe you can talk about that briefly. But I was, it just made me think, like, how can you tell the difference, like, when you're going through trials and stuff and, and losing a family member? Like, there's things that happen. And so how do you know if it is, you know, the shutting of doors that like God is saying, nope. Or how do you know if it is that or the enemy trying to prevent you from doing a work?
That's good. So yeah, with the shutting of doors, you know, in the natural, if you're looking at it, our travel over there, you could totally be like, they're not supposed to go. But because, especially for me and my extended time over there, I had so much peace in my heart. And I know that when I, like, I get excited about all kinds of things, but when I have that, like, overwhelming, nothing is going to shake me, nothing is going to deter me, excitement and peace in my heart about this trip. You know, so many people approach my parents. They're like, you're granted, I'm in my 30s, but people still, you know, your parents care about you and are still mm-hmm. a huge part of your life. They're like, I can't believe you're letting your daughter go and live in Africa. And they're like, she's going to be fine. They're like, she's living in a village. And I was like, I'll be fine. It's not the craziest thing I've done. And so,
true that.
You know, so many people are like, aren't you scared? Aren't you fearful for her? All of these things. And I was, you know, you have to put your flesh down every day. And I'm like, oh my gosh, like, there's all these things. They're like, you have to get these vaccines, you know, for yellow fever, and it could this and it could that, and you know, anything can kill you there. And I remember when we were going to Mozambique to Sideshow, Pastor Jim had told all of us, like, hey, you know, even for you younger ones, like, make sure that your finances are in order, you have a will, stuff like that. And I just kind of, I meant it in my heart and kind of smirked a little bit. And he's like, what are you laughing at? And I was like, if I die in Africa, just leave me there, because that's clearly where my heart wants to be. And it's way cheaper. And I was just kind of being a smart aleck. And he's like, that's the heart that we want to have going on this trip. And I was like, oh, okay. And so I made the comment again. I was like, if something happens to me in Kenya, like, celebrate my life here, but leave me there, because that is where my heart is. You know, I have a heart here in America, and the other half is definitely in Kenya. So with that, I had so much peace in my heart, even amongst all of the trials. We get up, Miss Natalie and myself were prepping for a lot of the trip. And by the time we made it to the Medford airport, and I think it was like 36 hours. Her and I slept for 30 minutes. So we were running on fumes. We were exhausted. We had packed all of the suitcases. Everything was great. We get to the airport. And so this was in January. And our plane had not been defrosted.
Oh, no.
So they were working on another plane. So we ended up missing that flight and sat in the Medford airport for like 4 hours. And ended up, it was just thing after thing. And in my heart, I was like, this is the enemy trying to deter us from getting there, because of the peace that I had in my heart, knowing without a doubt that I was supposed to get there, okay. no matter how, no matter what day it was, okay. no matter how bad we smelled, because it had been days, that we were supposed to be there. And so we had canceled flight after canceled flight and delay. We ended up staying the night in Salt Lake City with no luggage, because our luggage was sitting at the airport and we couldn't get it back. We finally arrived in Kenya. I think it was like a day or two late. And we had no luggage. So we were supposed to go from Seattle to, I think, France to Kenya, and we went from Medford to Salt Lake City to New York City to London, and then finally to Kenya.
Oh, my word.
We had no idea where our luggage was, and we had a conference the next day.
Yeah.
And so, you know, thank goodness for Miss Natalie. She's like, she always wears the cute dressy stuff. And I was like, I look homeless. This is neat. So, because I'd already worn my clothes from Salt Lake City. So we got to go shopping in Kenya and buy new clothing, which was really fun to figure out the size differences in clothing and shoes and all of this stuff. But, you know, we finally made it there. And it was just such a testament of God's hand on us, because even though it was stressful and chaotic getting there, and so many delays and spending so many hours in airports and going from desk to desk to desk, because I was on a different reservation than the rest of the team. So in London, they're like, it was 3 a.m. and they're like, okay, so she can't stay with you guys. She has to get on a tram. She has to go to this terminal. She has to go out of, basically out of the airport, back in through the desk, check in through security, go through customs again. And thank God for Pastor Jim and his dad moment. He's like, that is not happening.
Right.
And I was like, thank you, Jesus. Luckily, they spoke English there.
Right.
Because I was like, if this is another airport, I actually ended up crying in the middle of the airport. And I was like, it was horrible. But just God's hand. And they ended up getting everything worked out for us. We finally got our luggage like 3 days later.
Right.
So, and you were not separated from the group.
We were not separate. I was not separated from the group. I got to stay with everybody, which thank you, Jesus, because Heathrow is massive.
Right.
But it was just so good. And so I ended up getting to share that with the people when I was in Kenya about, you know, when you see things in the natural and they aren't working out, like you said, are you asking God, is this you closing the door, or right. is this the enemy trying to deter me from something? Mm-hmm. And so just praying in every situation, you know, even when it's 3 o'clock in the morning, you smell questionable, you look questionable, you're in a foreign country and people are like, is she okay? But just praying through it, being like, God, you've got your hand on me. I thank you that, you know, whatever door you open, the enemy can't close.
That's right.
And whatever door you do close for me, the enemy's not going to try. He can't open it no matter what. And I'm going to keep my hands off of that and just walk through it hand in hand with you. And yeah, so I got to share that with a lot of them that were there, because a lot of the kids have been through horrible situations. You know, none of the kids that are at Jami House wound up there because of a good scenario. And so getting to share with them, you know, bad things can happen in our life because of the enemy, and we live in the flesh and in the natural. But if you put your trust in God, he opens doors. The fact that you're in this home, the fact that you're getting an education, the fact that you have, you know, aunties and the pastoral staff there at Jami Home that love you so much, that make sure you're clothed, that are feeding you every day and sharing Jesus with you. That is a door that God opened for you that Satan can't close and can't take away from you, because what God gives us, the enemy, if he tries to steal it, he has to repay it back sevenfold.
Right.
And so just every situation that we went through getting there, was so cool, because God got to, we got to give the glory to God and use every one of those as a testimony for, you know, all of the things. So yeah, it was such an amazing trip. I can't, I'm like counting down the days to go back. I'm so excited.
Is there, I sit too long and then the frog settles, or the fog or the frog, whatever. Is there a scripture that you could leave with us to just kind of, maybe that just spoke to you, or that just something that you feel like the Lord's like, put this on blast, like put this word out there. Is there a scripture that
you want to share? There's so many in my heart right now. So one of the ones, because, you know, we, I think we go on mission so many times, to work, you know, we're building a church, we're building a house, we're doing this, we're doing that. I think people sometimes forget to focus that we're actually going on missions to build the church. We're going on missions to build the Spirit, and to spread that with people. And I think so many times, we look at getting to hang out and have fun. And I was so humbled because of the humility of the kids that I got to interact with and how hungry they are for Jesus. Like they even spoke into my life. And so the verse that had just kind of blessed me, because they are full of the word, they do have that faith, is Matthew 19, 14. And Jesus said, let the little children come to me and do not forbid them, for such is the kingdom of heaven. And so, you know, getting to interact with church and all of the fun things I got to do was really cool. But God really opened my eyes and humbled me to have their faith. You know, they're believing for families. They're believing. They have to believe every day that we're going to have food and that the water truck is going to come. Because we had days where the water truck didn't come, and we had to pray together and stand in faith that the truck was going to come so we could bathe, so we could wash our clothes, so we could have food. And just their faith in just the simple things, believing for school uniforms, believing for tuition. And so they really taught me that we pray and we stand in faith for every single thing, because nothing we get in this world is by our own might and our own power. So, yeah, just I encourage you guys and myself, just walk in that childlike faith, because when we walk with the faith that children have, That's when mountains move. And that's when you get to go to Africa.
Thank you for listening to the She Is podcast by Refuge City Church. We pray that you have been encouraged and equipped in knowing who you are in Christ. If you are wanting to have a personal relationship with Jesus, pray this with me. Dear Jesus, I know that you love me. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. Please come into my heart to stay and help me to hear your voice and grow in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Keep in touch between podcasts by finding us on Facebook and Instagram. The links are in the show notes. If you haven't already, be sure to subscribe to this podcast to hear more from us every week about who you are in Christ.